technically had 3 weeks to do it. We just had 2 weeks because we don't assume people are going to work on fall break. So we just gave you that buffer.
So you can submit it before 30.
No, you can submit it.
You guys submit it today.
I should create the Dropbox for that soon, actually, so you guys can submit it. Assuming nobody's quite ready yet. I'll do that soon. Okay, great. Okay, let's get started. So I know we kind of scared you. Oh, yeah.
So by appending duties to the table, so each column of duties you have to append one and separately, right?
Ooh, we're going to get to that. Now we just got started, so now we're going to go through the whole thing. The office hours is over. The impromptu ones. Now we're going to go through the structured norm. So we kind of scared you, at least we're trying to in the lecture and say that it's a long homework, but the idea here really is to step through and see that it's really not that it's that complex. But if you mess up, for example, the thing people most often mess up with this homework is the updating of the table, right? So they will simply append new rows, and so getting the rows to show up properly. So as long as you follow and be very methodic about the enter, the merging, and the exit, honestly, that's like the hardest part. Everything else is really rendering bars, rendering circles. It's not that hard, it's just a lot of little pieces that come together. Okay, and hopefully, so we're gonna walk through this really slowly today, and you can stop and ask me any questions. There are any stupid questions. And hopefully it'll make them a little bit more manageable. So, as I'm sure you guys have seen, and I'll start off by giving you a sneak peek of what the fully functional solution looks like. We have a table, and as you may see, especially if I stop doing this so quickly, when you, and let me sort actually by number of goals, when you hover over a team, you can see that the path of that team on the tree gets highlighted. Now, based on the map homework, does anyone have an idea, just like off the top of your head, of one way that maybe we could do that, that we could link the two? IDs, right? So just remember that instead of, you don't have to search the whole thing by giving IDs, and now we know that we're going to search by the country. So when you're giving IDs to these circles in your tree, just make sure to put the country name in that ID, okay? And it just makes it much easier to grab later. So these steps, as long as you follow some of these basic ideas that hopefully you've already been using homework, really shouldn't be that hard. So the idea is you have a table that you can sort by any of the columns. The goals, and this is the most unorthodox visualization that we're doing here, is really just a bar and two circles. This bar looks rounded. It's not. It's a rectangle that's underneath these two circles. So it's really just rendering three elements per cell here. Okay? And then we color them according to the data. So if this is bigger than this, we color the goals made blue and the goals lost red. So this is all, and the bar gets colored, as you can see, if the blue is greater than the red. Okay, so goals made and goals conceded, they go hand in hand. And as when we talk about how we're going to generate these data objects, you always want to have the two of them together, because even your fill for this doesn't depend just on one, but depends on both. Okay? We do give you in the data, there's a column called delta goals in the JSON file. Which is goals made minus goals conceded. And obviously that is the same, you can either do the math yourself, but that's already there and you can use that for other bar. Anyway, getting ahead of myself. So this is the in a sense, the hardest column to implement because you have three elements and you have to color three different things according to the data. This is not an SVG, this is just a text. This is like what we were talking about last homework lab. You don't need to create an SVG and put it as SVG text element. You can just, this is just a TD with a text in it. This is the simplest one. It's just you set the text value to the column result. And these are bars for the text. This is an SVG text. This is not. People try to put a regular HTML text here and they don't see it show up because it's an SVG. And then that doesn't work. Does that make sense? It's a common thing that people kind of mess up here. The tree, and Alex actually mentioned this after my class, the layout lecture, I threw way too much at you guys, and I ended up going, I gave you an example of the tree that was a little more convoluted. We're not doing any kind of collapsing or anything. But the tree is the shortest part of the homework. And I'm not saying don't worry about it, but I'm saying if you have all this work and you finally get the table done and you're like, oh, now I need to start the tree's a lot less code, it has that tree layout, you can really use what we did in class as an example. The only thing that's special about this tree is that we're coloring the nodes according to whether they won or lost, and you're gonna give IDs so that when someone hovers here, it highlights there. Those are kind of the unique things that make this any more exciting than a very boring D3 tree. This one I'm going to show you now is a functionality that is reserved only for graduate students, which is When you click on any country, it expands and shows individual games. This really highlights the structure of the data that you have two types of rows. One is what we call an aggregate row, which is pretty much a row that represents all of the games a country has played. And that is the default view, right? Total number of goals, what their final round result was, and the total number of wins, losses, and games. When you break it up, this, each one of these represents an individual game. And as you can see, we tried it, and we say this in the spec, we put a little X here to show it's Iran versus Nigeria, Iran versus Argentina, and so forth. So this, unlike the other ones, doesn't have any value for this because it's a single game, right? And so you can see whether they won or lost by the circles. And that's the extent of the interactivity in the final of what you're going to be doing. So spec, the things we want you to learn how to do, if you're doing the hacker version, is how to derive a data set. Honestly, when I first developed this homework, we didn't have any data, so I did that part, and that was a little bit time consuming, because you have to really get the nest and the syntax right. So we just want to reiterate, even if you think you're going to do the hacker version, you're feeling pretty confident and you're doing really well, do that in the end. Use our JSON file. When you're done and it's beautiful, go back to the hacker version, because you're going to find that you're going to spend more time than you thought you would, and then you don't have time to finish the homework, and that's just a waste. So the second thing is this custom visualization idea. So we wanted to do the goals, the goal column be a little different, so using dots and rectangles, working with a new type of layout, which is the tree layout. We're going to talk a little bit about filtering, which is this idea of selecting elements based on your data fields, okay, instead of just an ID or a class. Because you can imagine these cell arrays, you want to render them differently, whether they are bar types, bold types, or whatever. Right? So that's the type. And we're not going to add an extra ID that's, or an extra class that says bar type, bold type. We could, but we want to show you a different way of doing it, which is what you really care are all the TDs whose data is of type bold, for example. Right? So it's one level more nesting that you're going to do to filter through and say, now get me all of these TDs and style them one way. And we'll see exactly how to do that. And then the last thing, and I actually have some separate slides for this, is this association of data, how we're going to associate the data to the row, and then that's going to pass it down to its child elements, which is the TD, and how to do that.
What's TD?
A TD is a cell array. So in HTML, R is row, TD is cell. Okay. So we gave you some basic code, which we'll look at, and it's super short. You won't have to mess with that. If you're doing the hacker version, you are going to mess with script.js, but otherwise, so today we're actually going to skip the discussion on the hacker version. So you really don't have to touch script.js at all. If you've already downloaded the homework, as I was preparing for this lab, I realized that there was one sentence left over from last year, so I updated it, and it just means that there's no global variable, and there wasn't mention of a global variable here. So you might want to pull the latest one. And I added a few more tips as well. So the structure is we have all the data inside the data folder, figures you don't have to care about, and the three files we're going to be looking at, which is script, table, and tree. Render server, loading the data. So over here, we are going to, so we're going to skip the, let me just show you real quick the script.js that we gave you. Super short, hopefully at this point super intuitive, right? So we are reading two files in, FIFA matches and FIFA tree. Now these are nested because one relies on the other. We need both of them to set up our instances of our classes. That's why we don't have a FIFA JSON and then later a FIFA tree. So here we're just going through and creating a unique ID for each one and the way we do for each game. And what's unique about each game is the team and the opponent, right? So we pretty much just create this ID based on those two fields. Then we create a new tree object. And I know I've already said this before, but hopefully it's pretty clear. What function is new tree.calling? The constructor, right? So anything inside, I have to be very careful not to click on solution. So anything inside here, you'll notice that the constructor for the tree is empty, but the constructor for the table data has a whole bunch of stuff. And we put these in here so you didn't have to figure out what needed to be instantiated, but null just means that we didn't put anything there, fill those out. And we also gave you a few boilerplate things, like so you didn't have to figure out the cells and so forth. So the reason we create the tree before the table is because, as you can imagine, the table needs to know about the tree. Because when you hover over any of the games, we want to highlight the tree. right? We are no longer using global variables. So the only way that the table can know about a tree is if it passes that in as an object. So you'll see that inside of your, I don't know what it's not saying, inside here, we have a reference to the tree. So as you can imagine, once you pass it in, you need to save it there. And later we're going to call it whenever you hover. So now we create our tree. If you are going to, and I do suggest you do this, create the, work with the table before the tree, this isn't going to break. It's just going to be an empty, nothing, you know, it's just not going to have any functionality. This is not going to break. We create a new table, and we pass it in both the data that we got from our matches and the tree object that we just passed, create the table, and then update the table. The reason we call them separately is because, as you're going to see, create table really just does some structural things that you don't want to do every time, like create access for other goals and everything. An update table actually gets the data and populates it. Okay? So we're going to skip the Hacker version description, but I'm going to stop here so we can take a closer look at what the data looks like. And you want to become very familiar with this, because this is how you're going to understand how you're going to create the data objects that go into each cell. Okay? This is, as you can see, it has a lot of information. And every this is one per country. So I picked Brazil. And so if you every object inside of our array of data from our JSON file, the key is the country name, and the value has two levels. This top value here is the aggregate information. It's the summary of all the games. So throughout all of the World Cup, Brazil made 11 goals, conceded 14, did not do too great, delta goals of -3, and so forth. And then what you need to pay attention to here, one of the things you need to pay attention to, is that other than these aggregate values, we have this nested array of games. And notice that games looks a lot like the aggregate values in terms of the fields. The only difference is that we have an opponent. Okay? So the difference between the structure of the data for a game versus an aggregate is only that the games have opponents. Okay? And you can tell the difference because of type. This is type game, and that's type aggregate. And there's a reason why they look so similar. It's because when you click and expand the table, we want to render the rows exactly the same. The only difference is in the styling of that goal header, right? Everything else looks very similar. If our data looked different, we have to do that extra step of munching it into different parts. So every row in your data table is really just gonna, you can rely on necessarily having all of these, except for a moment. Okay, so we just talked about that. Okay, so the first thing you're going to do is you're going to add an x-axis. So you're going to do this axis right here. Right? Now, some of you already started implementing this, and one very valid question that came up on Slack was that if you look at the code that we give you a cell.width inside the table. It's constant, right? But if you look at the solution, you can see that there are three skinny columns and four skinny columns and two fat columns, right? So just use this as a multiplier. And honestly, you don't even have to use it. That was just a nice way of organizing if you wanted to look exactly at the solution. When you're setting up these cells, you have the width that you can reduce with these. When you're setting up these cells, you can set them to our solution uses twice that cell width. Okay? Is that clear? If you want to come up with numbers on your own, that's fine. What we do want to, what we were trying to suggest with that syntax is we want to avoid putting the numbers directly into the code. Width is 75 minus 4. The moment you want to change that, you need to change it everywhere. So we like this idea of having little objects. Oh, you know what? It's a little crowded. Let's make our table bigger. You change it one place, which is way at the top, cell.width. Okay? Another thing that we provide there is cell.buffer. I'm sure it's pretty obvious, but what that is if you only go, if your scale goes from 0 to cell.width, that means all your visualizations are going to touch up on the side of your SVGs. It's going to look super cramped. So just make your range, use that buffer to make it so your scales go to from buffer to width minus buffer. So actually, let me just open up the... all the order that we talked about. Yes, so here, this part here. This is where you're going to be populating all of these nulls. This is pretty straightforward, right? One thing I do want to point out here, and I say this in the spec as well, this table elements, some people can confuse with the original team data. Team data is everything. You're going to get your data in, you're going to store it, and that's never going to change. But as you can imagine, the table changes. What's available, what's viewed, what's on the table, and what's not changes. And so we created this copy of the team data, which is called table elements, after the name, which is where we only keep the stuff that we're visualizing. Okay? So when you first load it in, they're the same. Okay? And then as you click and expand and subtract, that changes. Table elements changes, team data doesn't. Okay? And this is the part that I copied in. So when you're going to copy something over in JavaScript, so here we're saying, right, as a first step, copy team data over to table elements, is you have to use the dot slice operator. Because in JavaScript, if you say A equals B, what happens is you're creating a reference. So B equals 2. And A equals B, A is also equal to 2, but the moment you change B, so does A change. So you can imagine that's a really hard bug to spot, because here you copied all your data over, and then you expanded it, and the moment you collapse it, you lose that data forever because you're modifying both of them. Okay? So what you want to do is just say A equals B dot slice. And you can look at the syntax, look it up in JavaScript, all it does is it makes a hard copy. And those two are no longer associated. Okay? Let's see if there's anything else I wanted to comment here. So we gave you these two because goals made and goals conceded has that space in between, and you know, we didn't want you to actually have to put the string and actually put the space in every time, so we just created a variable for it. It's just a nice syntax thing. You're going to set up all your scales here, and most of these scales are pretty straightforward. We even gave you the exact colors that we want you to use. The one thing to keep in mind here is when you're creating your goal scale, right? Because like we said before, goals are dependent on more than one data value. All of the other columns map pretty directly to a single column in our data. This depends on three values, right? Made, conceded, and the difference between them. There's really just two in the map. So when you create your scale, if you don't take that into account, what is the maximum and the minimum, you're going to have goal scale bars that don't account for the full data, and so you're going to plot it, and it's going to be way out here. You don't see your circle. You just see sort of rectangles, or you don't see any circles. So just pay attention when creating the domain for this. When you create the domain, think carefully of what attribute you want to use to set these values. So we're adding the x-axis, which will be much easier than the axis that you guys did for the bar chart for the last homework. And then we're going to create, so then we have the two types of rows, right? We have aggregate rows that contain the summary of all values, and we have specific rows that for each given match. And the table, I'm sorry, we're going to talk. And now we're ready to populate the table. So just to reiterate this, and I think sometimes the naming of the functions here isn't super intuitive, create table doesn't actually create the table, right? Create table actually means create these little things we're going to need on the side that are never going to update, which are the axes for the x, adding that goal axis, and eventually, towards the end of the homework, you're going to come back and set the sorting callback. So if you unclick any of those headers, it sorts it. We're going to come back and do that here. These are things that don't change. We call create table once. We call update table all the time. Okay. Now we're going to actually go through what you need to do to populate the table. Just to mention here that we did decide to do an HTML table. And the reason for that is because it had the formatting of where every cell goes. It's kind of implicit with an HTML table. So when you add TEs, they go one next to each other. If you do an SVG, for each SVG, you need to set the X and the Y and translate. So just to make it a little nicer, the problem with HTML tables is they don't have these nice transitions. So you don't get the nice like table rows swooshing up and down. So people are not using transitions in this one. Okay, so this is how we're going to populate the table. We're going to add bar charts for the wins and losses, so those last three columns, wins, losses, and total games. We're going to have this custom goal chart for the number of goals made and conceded, and we're going to have the round results of the text element. This part here, I'm gonna go through some sides to make it clear, because this is where people mostly get, so we're gonna go through this kind of slowly, which is, we are associating, we have two levels of data. We have TRs and TDs. TDs are nested within TRs, they're cells, right? But because every column, every data element is associated to a country, we want to associate that data to the entire row and then break it up for, so that each column gets put in one TD. And the way I'm going to do it is, I guess I'm going to go through these slides and we'll come back. And I'm going to post a link to these. These are really helpful because they actually, I did these examples with the actual data from the homework. Okay. So, we have the body of our table, and we're going to select, and this body already exists, right? Because we gave you the skeleton of the table, it just doesn't have any rows in it. So we select all the rows, which are TRs, we associate the data, and then for all the new ones, enter, we append TR. Okay? Hopefully this makes sense. So let's suppose our data looks like this. My data has four elements, and each one of them looks like this, which is the exact same data that we looked at before in the spec, right? We have the key in Brazil, and the value is this object that has all of these attributes, delta, poles, and so forth. My question to you is, what is the size of TR? How many TR elements are there once I run this code? If you think one, raise your hand. A half raise. If you think two, not gonna, this is gonna be too slow. If you think four, two hands. Any number I haven't said. No clue whatsoever. That's fine. So, if remember how if we did the rects, just a very basic example, if I said d3.selectAllRect.data, and we gave it a dot data, an array had four numbers in it, okay? Dot enter dot append rect. So I'm gonna visualize that code. Select all rect, data has an array of four elements, dot enter dot append rect. How many rectangles do we have?
Four,
right? The idea being every data element gets it, right? This is similar, but instead of recs, they're TRs. So they're just DOM elements. They're not SVG, but they're still DOM elements. So we're selecting all instead of recs, TRs, and our data, instead of being an array of four boring numbers, is an array of four interesting objects. Still an array, still four data elements, they're just complex data elements. Using that same argument that we did for the rectangles, how many TRs do we have? Right? We're mapping one data element to one DOM element. Every TR gets one of these objects. And raise your hand if that's not clear, because that needs to be clear before we, okay. So if we replaced it, instead of my data was an element of four, my data was, and I want to show you this one here, my data was that, 13, 40, 1, 5, 12, 30, right? And we did select all TR, data is this, dot enter dot append TR. You would get one TR per one of those, right? The TR would have the data associated to the number 13, 40, which you can do something or not, anything with it, whatever. You just have that data associated to that TR. This is the same concept, except instead of the array being of numbers, it's an array of objects. So it's the same concept of one, every element in my array gets a corresponding DOM.
Where I'm confused is I thought my data was an object for each and every team, each and every country.
It is. It's an array of objects. So look at this real quick. If you look at this, see that bracket up there?
Mm-hmm.
And this one? It's an array of these, of an object that has all of these things. This one just says one.
So then wouldn't you have the number of TRs, wouldn't it be the same number of countries?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, I thought you said there was four.
Huh?
I thought you said there was four TRs.
There are, sorry, I guess what wasn't entirely clear is there are four of these. This is one of them.
Okay.
So this is just me showing you that my data has four of something that looks like this. This is not the whole thing, this only has one.
Okay.
You're right, if it was just this, it would just be one. But if we imagine, because in our homework that's what we have, an array of a whole bunch of objects that look like this, then we create one row per object, which happens to have all the information we need. We're going to break that down. Okay? So this is exactly the syntax you're going to use to create your rows. Okay? So now you have rows. If you don't want rows, you want cells within those rows. So we're going to break that down. And this is where a like that even knowing, I just know this is the way it works, I don't think it's automatically intuitive, this idea of passing data down from parent to child. So your TD is going to be your TR, select all TD. TR is your rows, and for each row, you're going to select all TD. Okay? Then you have a dot data, which just like, I won't hold it against you if you guys do not remember me saying this, because I talk nonstop for an hour and a half during the lecture, but this idea of a dot data, not having a data element in it, but having a function called in it. Does anyone here remember why or why that's okay? Because so far, we've only seen dot data calls that actually have data in it, right? Instead of dot data, an array, we have dot data, a function. Does anyone remember either from what I said or want to take a guess at why that's okay? Yeah?
I just put an array in the food. Just to use the array for the data.
Oh, so you're saying that this function, so this is the equivalent of putting just that?
Is it?
No, but that's a good guess. And the reason it's no is because see how this function has these two parameters? Where are these coming from? Yeah.
The
TR
has data associated with it.
Yes. So the idea is when you do a select all on a D3 selection that has data, you're saying, okay, so I have this parent element, select all my TD, so instead of D3.selectAll, we're now doing it one level nested of selection.selectAll. Okay? So you're saying take my TRs within those select all my TDs, and my data is going to be a function of my parent data. Right? So if we think back to our parent data that looks like this, we can now take whatever interests us from this object, right? Because every TR has one of these. Now we're going to say, okay, our TDs are now going to be a subset of these, or subset of this data. If we wanted, we could just copy this data into the TD as is. But we know that every TD in our table means something different. So we are going to go through and we're going to take this for the first TD, these three for the first TD, the whatever for the second TD, and so forth. So we're going to kind of pick and choose, yeah.
So that D within your function is one of those elements.
Yes, that's exactly what it is. So this D accesses, right? Now, in this syntax, which is a super simplified example, we're not even using the D. Because all I really want to make clear here is that we're using that those numbers, but then we're not using the parent data, but the parent data does pass it down. So what happens here is that every TR, if you wanted to access the data from the TR node 0, 1, 2, 3, you don't actually use that syntax in Homer, but that's kind of how you would access each one of those four. And so using that same code, my question is, for that, in this example here, not the 1, 2, 3 example there, how many cells are we creating for that row?
Six.
Forget those on the top, that was an exact example in my view. So there's six elements in our array, right? We create six cells. So this is our TR as the plaque, and then I just cut them up. And what is the value in each cell?
13, 40, whatever.
So I guess what I want to make clear here is, are we copying that whole array into each one, or are we putting one into each one? Right? So just break it up. So this is a simple example. You guys can be doing exactly the same thing, but with a little bit more of a catered what data goes where. Okay? And this is actually just a sanity check. When I say the size of TD, what I mean is if you see how many elements are in here, how many elements, if you do a TD that's not, that selection has how many TDs in it?
Six times however many.
Six times what?
However many your other one was, so like four?
Yes.
What you said.
Yes. And that's important to note because we have 24 elements, and the reason I wanted to print that out is because it looks like you're only doing this once. You're doing this for as many elements as you have in TR. So you're going to pretty much, it's like going through your whole table and say for each R create cells for all our many games you have.
But now example, one more question. TR has two values, right? This T value and then object value. There are two.
Yes, we have key and we have the object, and we're going to use those depending on where we are, right? For example, we want the key on that first one, right? Which is the name of the countries, and we're going to use the value for all the other ones. So it's just a little bit more
so
how we
go inside the value as well.
Yes, absolutely do. But all of that, so let me just repeat his question, because I think it really points out, where are you going to be doing this?
So it would be a function inside function.
Not really. So if when you do function D, you know, this is the data object with everything, the key and the value. And inside here, you can manipulate it as you wish. So inside your function, you can say d.value.goalsMain, and so forth. Okay, and then the last thing I want to cover as far as concepts that you're going to need for the homework is this idea of filtering. So we just talked about, so you have TD, which has all of your TDs. You have a, sorry, that didn't make any sense. So in this here, RTD has 46, right? In our example, 24. You only care about a subset of them when you go to populate it, because you only care about TDs. To put on the rect bars, for example, you only care about the ones that are type goals. So we'll talk a little bit about how our data is going to have a viz field, but this year you're going to use extensively in your update. Because before, we were saying select all rect, and then we appended, but we had the luxury of only have rect, or only have circles, or inside a certain group only have a certain type. Now you're mixing, in a given row, you can't even do it based on the row, you're mixing different types of visualizations. So the way you do it is as you go along, this is the idea of you are no longer selecting by ID, you're not selecting by class, you are selecting by the data. And the way that you select by data is by filtering. That was the last of the little side notes. Now I'll post those slides, but seriously, that syntax is, if not exactly the same, very close to what you're going to use in your own.
But even that slide is posted?
Not yet. I will post it. Okay, so here we're talking about the different, we're going to do these three, we're going to do bar charts, customs. Okay, and this is the formal explanation of what I just went through, but I think the example that we stepped through just makes it very clear how this parent-child selection happens. So, same thing, right? That we just looked at. So we're not passing new data in because we have the function. I'll let you guys read that just because I realized somehow we only have 20 minutes left. Use console to see what the data looks like in here. And that's going to be really useful. So you're going to start off with that basic structure there, that data function D, just do a console.log D. Just to see. Yes?
Could you remind me, how does you get the data from TR?
So the data from TR is implicitly passed down. That the data from TR is that D right there. This is the data bound to TR. Okay, because it got passed down to the TD. Let me see if I'm not missing anything. Okay, so as far as the values that we care about, when we first start, we're only looking at aggregate. Rows. So for the entire country, but we're also eventually going to look at games. So, well, the function inside here needs to return an object. Okay? An object. And I'll tell you why. I don't know who asked over there. Sorry, I might be looking wrong person. Thank you. It's rude, right? One person asking to my answer. Because the data that returns there is what is going to be associated to each cell. If you recall from here, in our super simple example, we were associating one number to each cell, but we need more than that, because each cell needs to know what type of visualization are you, what is the data that you want to visualize, and are you an aggregate or a game? Those are three things you need to know. So we need to create that object.
Basically, an array of objects, right?
Yes, it will be an array of objects, each of which will be associated to a TD. So your object is going to have these three fields, type, viz, and value, right? And you have access to the type because the data had game or aggregate in it. What you don't have access to, you have access to the value, right, because that's part of the data. You don't have access to the viz. So this is the logic where you say if If it's total games, the type's going to be bar, right? If it's results, the type is going to be text, right? So you pretty much have to do the logic, because that label you're putting in as a visualization expert, which you will then later use to filter. So we tell you here to use those three, and then the types can be bars, goals, or text. It could be bars. Yeah. It could be any name that you want. You just use those. Okay. Bar charts. Here, we're going to select, so you've created all your TDs. Now you're going to select all of the TDs that are of type goals, for example. Once you have that selection, start 1 second, you're going to go through and create rectangles, just like you did for previous ones, okay? And this is where people get messed up. Your TD has an SVG in it, right? So you really are only going to append an SVG first time. If you automatically append an SVG every time you do this, your new SVGs are going to be on top of your old ones, and that's going to slow it down, and it's going to break, and when you update, you're going to have SVGs that are where they shouldn't be because you didn't update the position. It's a nightmare. So this is where I say, be very careful with your enters, your updates, and your exits. Yes?
Yeah, just want to go back to the side.
Yeah.
Okay. I just want to make sure that the D in the dot data should be the data from TR.
Yes.
And if we for the following information, like dot attribute, we use the D again. This D is the data for the TD from the TR.
That is correct. And the reason for that is because it is the data for the selection that's calling it. When you do selection.attribute, that D is the selection here, right? This D here is from this selection. This is the closest selection. You want to go up to the closest selection. This is going to be a selection and save in TD, but right now, TR is the selection, so this function is associated to this. That D is this. When later you say td.attribute fill blue, that attribute, that function, D, is associated to TD because it's the closest selection. Hold on to that question just so we can get through everything, okay? So for example, see this, we do say you create a new SVG element and you add a rect and use the cell width, right, as cell. This is super straightforward, right? You guys have done this a million times. And even though that's what you're doing, people will do this, it will show up, like this homework's not hard at all, I'm a genius. But then, when you go to update it, it breaks. So even though we're saying append an SVG, you're only appending an SVG to the new stuff, okay? And maybe one way that's gonna become clear is you do it, it breaks, and you go, that's what you were talking about. So we're gonna color these bars, and then we're going to add, how about I put text here? Labeled with a numeric value. Alright, so you add bars and you add text. Goal charts, what we talked about. Two circles and a rect. The marks, the red are for conceded goals, blues are for made goals, and the only time you have to do any math at all is for the blue bar. Speaking of colors, we now gave you a CSS file because our CSS is growing to the point we no longer include it in the HTML. So feel free to use these as classes. Okay? Winners, losers. So for example, the winner circle. Oh, these are for the tree, right? The circles we want to do winner for red and loser for blue and so forth. You don't have to, but these already have nice colors.
Do you know what class you use for the bar?
The bar? For the goal?
Bars?
Which bars?
The rects. The rect.
So that one you have to fill according to the data, so you can't use a class.
Oh, okay.
Right, yeah. Okay. So like even the bars in between, I mean, if you can't fill it, Sometimes we just give you a stroke. So I think you see gold bar, yeah. The gold bar is the middle one. We set opacity to 0.6. Does that look nice and stuff like that? But for the fill, you can still use the class just won't have a fill. Okay, so we create the gold charge with those three elements. Gray markers are used for ties. So anything that looks like that, they have exactly the same number of poles.
The numbers inside the bars are the meters for students.
The number inside the bars, what numbers? No, oh, these?
Inside the bars, yeah.
You tell me. So. So can anyone else answer? Are these numbers regular text elements?
No.
No, they're not. Why not?
Because your SVG would be overlapping them.
Because this is an SVG, right? The bar underneath, you don't want to mix the two. Both SVGs. Okay? And so it's an SVG text element. It's just not a DOM text, like a DAV or a SPAN. Okay, now this part, adding games, is not nearly as complex as you would think. And I won't read through it because you guys can read through it later, but I'll explain the concept. The concept is, remember how we had that table called table elements? Right, way in the beginning of the, that is pretty much a list of everything we're gonna show. And if you compare this line to that line, they are very, very similar. The data's in the same format. Only difference is we style them a little bit differently, and they don't have any values for here, so those are just empty. But as long as when you create your data, you leave those attributes for empty, this is just not going to show up. You don't have to handle these as special cases. So if they render the same, what would you think is the only thing we're changing to make them show up in the table? We have our initial table with only the aggregate teams, right? You click on something, and you want them to show up in the table. What needs to get updated? Table elements. That's it. You're going to update table elements and call update table, and it's going to magically show up. This idea of, and I think that it looks kind of fancy. You're not pushing stuff down, translating groups, nothing like that. All you're doing is going to your table elements and adding and removing rows, and you have to add them in the right location because, as you can see, this gets rendered in the same order that they are in table elements. So you just find where this game is in table elements, and you insert the games. Where can I find the games associated to a country?
I
didn't hear any.
ID.
ID. No. I want to find the actual data for these games.
Index.
So index is going to help me find where this lives in the table elements. Yeah.
The data binded to that row.
Yes, but the data bound, exactly. The data bound to that row has these games, but where? I want to know is like
games. Here's the value of the game.
Yes. That's what, remember we were looking at how, so value, so whatever your data is, dot value dot games, has exactly what you need. This is the array that you're adding to your team element, to your table element. Okay. It's already there, it's associated to that cell, and once you click on it, you go to your team element and you insert it in the right place. So this is where you're going to use splice again, and I added that to the README as well. Splice is an array operator that will not only do a shallow copy, but will actually insert and remove elements. So just to do a help on the documentation for dot splice, the important thing here is, and this is where the logic can get a little fuzzy, this is the update table function, not update list. You want to insert it in the right place. And what happens when you click on a country again? So you need to be able to add it, and you need to be able to remove it. Okay? So really just think about those indices. When you add it, find the index, and then use splice to introduce the value.games. And when you click on it, you go and you remove those games. Okay? How do you know how many games to remove?
Length of games.
Say that again?
Length of games.
Yes. And that's something that, you know, sometimes people don't know how many to take out. You know because you still have that array of games associated to that cell. So you just go and splice off data.value.gamesLength.
Yep. What will happen if you sort of like...
That's a very good question. So we didn't want to complicate it. One of the things, and we just talked about in the spec, when you sort, it collapses everything by default. Just goes through and takes everything out. The collapse all, that's this function here that you guys have input, this collapse list, is much easier than you would think, right? Because you know which ones are games, which ones are aggregates. Go through your table elements and splice off anything that is not an aggregate. One thing that honestly, I think it was one of the students last year who told me this, which I thought was genius, which is if you start from the top of the table and you splice stuff off, then your index doesn't mean anything anymore, right? Because if you're at 1, 2, and then you splice off 3, 4 is no longer associated with what you thought it was. So what's the solution? Start at the bottom. Yeah. Just start at the bottom and you're doing your cleanup. Start at the length and move your way up and just remove anything that's a game. It just makes your code so much simpler and it's really beautiful. So we're almost done here. Yeah, so this is where you click and it updates it, and I'll let you guys read this specifically, but really the idea is just what we're seeing. Modify team element to update your table. Okay. Use a slice operator to insert and remove, call update table and watch the magic happen. I guarantee you that everyone, including myself when I wrote this, when you call update table, something will not work the way you expected. That's okay. And it's something in your enter, update, exit selections. Collapse list, which is what we were just talking about, remove everything that's a game. Sorting, when you click on a table header, so you pretty much select all your table headers and you do an on click. And you have to check if it's sorted or not. If it's not, grab all those elements, sort them, and then call update table again. Okay, so you pretty much modify the data and then call update table. The tree. So the tree data, so this is exactly like one of the examples we talked about in class. We gave you a CSV file. And we want you to build a tree. So you have to use this stratify that will create the hierarchy that gets fed into the tree layout algorithm. Follow the example we did in class. Very straightforward. The nice thing about you guys this year is that last year was the first year that V4 had just come out, and all the examples on the internet were version 3, pretty 3. So people would find the example and then still have to make it work because there was no merge before V4. So you guys at least have a whole year's worth of examples out there that you can follow and not have that problem. So like the example of classes of V4 one that you guys can use. That creates the tree. And then the last part is this idea of linking. And one thing I do want to note on the linking is that you also want the linking to work for these. And so here's something that people would not understand why this wasn't working, which was, remember how the game had that extra field called opponent? So when you're hovering over a game, you care about the opponent. So don't just check for the team name, also check team opponent when figuring out which links to highlight. Those are the two relevant fields. Because this has Germany versus Brazil, so you want a link that connects Germany and Brazil. All of the Germany associated games or Germany and Brazil associated games. My point just being, don't forget that opponent attribute. It's important for the linking. One of the things that you need to do for the tree, so you're doing this update tree and this clear tree. Update tree is the function that takes in a row of data. So all that your tree does, I'm sorry, all that your table does is when you hover over any of the rows, not just any of the T name, any TR, and that TR is associated to a country. When you hover over it, send the whole thing over to the tree and let the tree handle all the linking. Don't have your table select links on the tree. That's too much integration between two visualizations. So all you're saying is, hey, update the table with this information, update the tree with this information, and the tree says, oh, this is the country you're looking at. I'm going to go through all my links, and I'm going to highlight the ones that are relevant, and so forth. Okay? Use classes for these. And by for these, I mean, you'll see that we have a selected and a selected label. So you're going to be using a lot of class in the tree. Get the row, find all the ones that are the relevant game or opponent, do a class selected, and then once the user hovers away from it, class selected is off. Okay? Okay. The other function that you have to implement, which is ridiculous, it's two lines of code. Clear the tree. And by that we mean clear all of the selections in the tree. Right? If we're doing selection of classes, clearing links and nodes is very straightforward, right? So this is like the easiest part. Let me see if I forgot anything. The one thing I decided to do this time, the last time I was struggling to look at the solution while not showing it to you guys, is I put the solution on my iPad because I find it sometimes just going through it and making sure there's nothing here that might trip you guys up. And that's worth mentioning. In the meantime, think of any questions you guys might have. Okay, so don't forget to use your buffers. The sorting logic is not super straightforward. I mean, the sorting code is about this much for the solution, because if you think about it, it's different for every column, right? Sorting alphabetically versus sorting by goals versus sorting by and so forth. So it just means check for which type it is and then do the sorting logic. One nice thing that I found that makes it very easy to debug is this whole idea when you're separating enter, update, and merge, is to actually call tr, tr enter, tr merge, have the enter selection be called tr enter, have final tr equals tr dot, tr enter dot merge tr, so that every step is very clearly, avoid chaining. Chaining is the part where you go from a selection, the moment you do it on click, so if you do a select all, associate the data, then you do an attribute, and you finish with on click, do this, if all of that is chained, your variable up top no longer refers to a selection. So you want to do tr equals select all td dot data dot enter dot append, stop. Then later you take your tr dot on click, do this. Separate those out, because the output of dot on click is not a selection anymore. So just break it up as much as you can, that helps with a lot of bugs. The filtering you're going to use a lot. One thing that you're going to do is a tooltip, and I think we have this implemented in the four. Yeah. You can't see it very well. The bar, the goals scored has a tooltip, which means it's just a title attribute, and in there we put the number of goals scored and the number of goals conceded. That's in the spec. Just use the dot title attribute of the cell. Yeah, then there's that logic that we talked about for updating the list. I think that's it. I think that I looked at this before I came here, so I think I remembered everything. Oh, the last thing. And this is actually very similar to the example. When you're drawing these links here, these paths, you see how they have a nice little curved look to them? They are a custom path generator. They're actually exactly the same one I used in lecture, so it's this little, right? If you wanted to, I don't know why you would, you could substitute it with another path generator. Maybe it's a squiggly thing, whatever. This is not d3.line, the d3. Anything like that. It's actually a function that takes data and returns the path, move this and there. You don't have to figure it out. That's in the example, and that's on any. Any of Mike's blocks on trees. Okay, I think that's it. Any questions?
Can we do the file of the home book?
Yeah.
Is it function?
I'm pretty sure it is. I just didn't go through the. But on Slack, I'm always available for questions, and then I will be holding office hours fall break, and I might even just do two sessions or something, because two solid weeks that I'm not around for office hours. So if you haven't handed it by then, I'll be more than happy to help with that. Okay? Yeah?
Any tips for the exam?
You know what? I'm so hands-off with the exam, I'm all about homeworks. I'm trying to remember from last year's exam things that trip people up. Don't be super verbose on correct things. There's a design study, there's a design study last year, design critique, and people like wrote 2 full pages and you trip yourself up. Okay, so be concise, a paragraph is more than enough. Yeah, go through his slides. He tends to ask things that he has specifically mentioned in class. Like knowing what are the marks, the more important visual marks, is color more important than size, those kinds of things that you know. Yeah, that's not super helpful. They're a lot easier than any of the homeworks. And he'll ask you to find maybe a little problem in some, like he'll give you a little snippet of code and say, what's wrong about this? And you know, with the homeworks, it's really not something that's too complex. It's something along the lines of the enters and appending something. That was one of the questions from last year. So I feel like the homeworks are pretty good prep. The homeworks don't really prep you as far as theory goes, because honestly, when I was correcting the homeworks, I had the solutions next to me because I didn't remember exactly what he had said about marks, right? I mean, this was a long time ago. Go through the slides. It's a good preparation. There's a question in the back.
So is there any syllabus for an exam?
Is there a what?
On syllabus, like...
Oh, everything that is shown. Yeah, someone asked him that as we were leaving class, and he actually called confused, like, yeah, everything. That's the answer.
Is the path generator same to like what we did on scene in the tutorials at the last? There was a path generator and then the curves for the reading of the path. And one of the tutorials was there. And a path is generated in normal lines, straight lines, and then the other curve in the lines.
I don't remember what you're talking about.
The path for the trees.
Yeah, so that's in the tree. That is the path that we use in the tree example that I gave on
yesterday.
On. Else? How are you guys feeling about this one? Manageable, maybe? Okay? This is as bad as it's going to get. The next one is easier. It's a nice little electoral map. Actually, that doesn't make it better, does it? This is as bad as it's going to get. Yeah, just pay attention to your intro. All of the problems last year with the office hours where people were doing, just changing everything. It works the first time. The moment you update your tables, I don't work anymore. Okay, that's like the biggest difference possible. And feel free to ask questions outside. There's a lot of people answering. Sometimes I can't get to it right away, but don't be shy. Don't write to me personally until the general homework channel hasn't answered it, because then I have to ask you to write it in the general homework channel. And then so write it there, and then if we can't debug it, we'll say, hey, send me your code. Okay? Yeah.
How do you use the color value from the CSS used in the color value?
I lost you there. I tried.
Yeah, I'm trying to all the color value in the CSS.
You can't if it's a scale. If you're doing it, because I think what you're saying is you want to have a range of colors and have that defined in your CSS. If you're using data to define anything, it needs to be done dynamically between JavaScript and Vue, because you need to do the mapping of if it's 5, it's blue, if it's 2, it's red. That kind of continuous mapping has to be done by JavaScript. The only thing you could do, let's suppose you had a CSS class, and don't do this, it's horrible, for every number. Is 5, is 6, is 7, is 8, and each one of those classes had a color associated to it. Yeah, that would work. But as you can imagine, it's not flexible, doesn't work the moment you change your data. So if you are not doing one class for one color, you have to do it with the scales in JavaScript.
So if I
want
to use some color map, I can
use any kind of
is it printing this?
Yes.
Anything else? Well, thanks for coming. I know it's late.